I love that song she just sang. It's just precious. But I'm telling you this, I listened to this son-in-law of mine praying and different people praying and talking about needs. And there's one thing I'd like to say, and this is from my heart. When you start praying for somebody or for something, mean what you're praying. Believe. This Bible talks more about belief than it does anything else. Believe what you say and ask. Yes. Because if you don't, you might as well not even pray. Because, you know, I have, it's just me, but I have, and I've seen other people do this very thing. I've seen them go to the altar and get on their knees and pray for something, pray for needs or some other thing, and pray for somebody, and they get up and walk away. Well, I wonder how they're going to get that straightened out, or how they're going to, that's going to happen. You know, what good did it do to pray if you're going to question what you did? So if you pray for someone, as you walk away, say, thank you, Lord, for taking care of that need.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for taking care of that need.
Yes.
And I was listening in a Sunday school class this morning about the need of this lady back here, and it just thrilled my heart to hear what they're doing about it. And the main thing is to pray about it. I don't care what the doctors say, it doesn't make any difference. But they don't know this great big God that we serve.
Great position.
I'm telling you.
That's right. Yes.
Because he can do what he says he'll do, and what that Bible says he'll do it, he'll do it.
That's right.
Father, we thank you again, Master, for another time to stand behind this sacred desk. And Father, as I move into this word this morning and move into the things that I want to talk about for a little while, that you'll bless us. Just move in this place this morning by your Spirit in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. As I was thinking about what he was talking about praying for her, and I was just thinking a little bit about something that happened to me, and I want to tell you a little bit before I climb into this word for just a little while, and I'll try not to keep you very long. But one time there in Oklahoma, I was doing some work for a lady, and down the street from us, that her husband had died some time back, but she needed some work done. And I started to discover that I couldn't find my tools. And I'd worked on, had tools of all kinds. And I found out, I'd lose them tools. I'd lay them down, and I couldn't find them. And she finally came in, and I was talking to her, and I told her, I said, Sissy, I don't know what's going on with me, but I can't do anymore. You'll have to get somebody to finish this. And I went back home to the house, and in a while, and I told the wife, I said, Mother, you know there's something going wrong with me. I said, I'm going to have to go to the doctor and find out what's taking place. And I did. I went to the doctor, and the doctor said, you had better go see a specialist. I went to see a specialist, and they run me through the scans and the head scans and the whole bit, because I told them that I was losing my mind. And my wife was having to drive down Tulsa. I couldn't even get on the steering wheel and drive down Tulsa someplace I'd been hundreds of times. I couldn't even remember how to get there. And I said, I don't know what's taking place. And the doctors went to scanning me, and then one night we went to church, and this pastor, the minister, was preaching that night. I told Mother, I said, Mother, I'm going up and let him pray for me. And when I stepped up in front of him, he said, Brother Don, I will pray for you. He said, first he laid his hands on my head, and then he took them off. And I said, Brother Burton, what's going on? He said, Brother Don, I want to tell you something. He said, God is showing me that you have got four tumors on your brain. And I said, I have. I said, where are they at? He said, you've got two big tumors on the back of your brain. You've got one right above the right ear. No. He said, you got two in the front part of your brain. He said, you've got one above your right ear, back here in the side. You've got one on the stem. I said, all right. And I went on and tell the mother, and mother was there. She knows the whole story. And But God had showed us. And that was before we'd ever been before the specialist. And we went back to check to see what the test read. And the specialist said, "I got some bad news for you." And I said, "Yeah, I know." He said, "You know?" I said, "Yeah, I've got 4 tumors on my brain." And he said, "Well, how did you know?" And I said, he said, "Have you had them scanned?" I said, "No." I said, "God showed us." Well, he looked at me like I was some kind of a nut. And I said, "God showed us." And they went on testing and done their tests. And he finally said, "Mr. Whitney," he said, "I'd like to, if you'll let me," he said, "I don't know why these are there, but," he said, "I want to go in the one I can reach and see if there's anything cancerous about this on the back." I said, "Well, all right." And I went on into the hospital, and I got a big scar on the back of my head. They cut that open and went into the one they could reach. And he come back out to me, and I was laying in that hospital bed waiting for him. But anyway, when he came back out and told me, he said, "Mr. Whitney," he said, "I'll have to tell you something." And I said, "What?" He said, "I can't find nothing wrong with it." He said, "You've got the tumors there, but," he said, "they seem to be going down." And I said, "We already know about that."
Amen.
I said, "We know that they're going down."
Amen.
And he said, "I don't understand." I said, "I do." He said, "Well, what?" And I said, "Satan is trying to kill me." I said, "People can look at you kind of silly if they want to. But I say, there's powers in this world that people don't really understand."
That's right.
And I'm going to tell you, Satan, the Bible says he's out to steal, kill, and destroy.
That's exactly right.
And he was doing his best to do it to me. But I want you to know something. God took care of them tumors in my brain. And I went back to the specialist in a year. I got up, it was supposed to be a year. Now listen to this. Supposed to be a year, and God wasn't quite through. He was still wanting to use me. And God, I was starting to do all right. And I told my mom, I said, "Mama, isn't it time we go back to see that doctor?" And she said, "Yeah, I believe it is, Dad." She made the appointment and went back in to see the specialist and sat down in the waiting room. And this Indian family came in. And just me and mother was sitting there in that waiting room. But this family came in, and mother and 2 daughters. Their daughters looked like they might have been 30, 40 years old. Anyway, I began to talk to them, which I can talk to anybody. And I started talking to them, and I began to talk to them, and they would begin to tell me about their problems, about their mother, how she had fell, and I don't know what she had broke, but anyway, God was there. But I began to talk to them about God. And this one looked at me, she was sitting there pretty close to me, and she said, "Well, I don't want nothing to do with God. I served him one time, and he never done nothing for me." And I said, "Sissy, you're thinking about it wrong." And she and their mother told her, said, "Well, I'll tell you this." She planted her daughter on her leg, was by her, and she said, "She would go along and her husband fell dead." Then she pointed her other daughter over and she said, "Then they built a big brand new home and it burned down." And I said, "People, don't you understand?" I told them just like I told you a while ago. I said, "Satan is out to steal, kill, and destroy." And he'll destroy anything that he can destroy trying to get to you.
Yes.
And they looked at me kind of funny, and by that time the doctor called them on in. And a little bit while they called us in, and we was back in the room, and I told mother, I said, "Mother," and I was thinking about a scripture, and I asked mother if she could write better and faster than I can. I said, "Write it down." And she wrote that scripture down, and I said, "I've got to give this to that little lady." And I went back, and she said, "We better go do it." So I went back out there. The doctor was standing out there talking to these ladies. And the one I wanted to talk to, he was standing talking to. And I walked up to him and to her, and I patted him on the shoulder. And they turned around and looked at me, and I said, "I'm sorry, I don't mean to butt in on y'all. But," I said, "God told me to give this scripture to you." And I gave that scripture to that little lady. And she stood there and read that scripture. And she stood there and started bawling. She reached out and put her arms around me and gave me a big old hug. And I turned around and headed back for the room, and the doctor was right behind me. This was a doctor. I thought I was crazy when I told him, God, heal me. And he come in there and he said, what are you all doing here early? He said, I told you to come back in a year. He said, it's only been 10 months. I said, well, I wasn't thinking. I said, God, I feel that God told us to come up here. And he looked at me kind of silly. And he said, well, I want to check it anyway. And I sat up on the table. You know how they'll set you up on the little table? I sat up on the little table, and he started feeling my head where he cut me open and the whole bit. And he finally said, I sat there talking to him about things. And he finally looked at me and he said, I want to tell you something. I said, what's that? He said, I don't want no more scans of you of no kind. Didn't he, Mom? He said, I don't want no scans, no tests, no nothing. He said, you just go ahead and live your life like you're going. You're doing all right. I'm telling you, if you'll believe, God will do it.
Yes, hallelujah.
I'm telling you, God will do it.
Yes.
I don't have the time, but I can tell you time after time how that God has come on the scene for me down through my years. My son-in-law was talking about a while ago how long I've been at this. And we was talking about it here the other day and figured out I've been ministering the gospel for 55 years. But I want to tell you this. God is just as real today as he was 55 years ago, if not greater.
Glory.
Every day I serve him and walk with him,
yes,
he's greater.
That's right.
Every day.
That's right.
And I'm telling you, there is nothing in this world that God can't do.
Amen.
We serve a God that you would not believe.
That's right.
He can do it.
Yes.
But I'll tell you, it's just something, guys. But there's one thing that's important, and that is serving him. Not something out here in the world. But now I know that we have to live in this world where we're at. We have to live here. We have to work and do the things we have to do in this world. But please, whatever you do, don't be a partaker of the things in this world.
Amen.
Only what God gives you and helps you to get along in.
That's right.
Nothing that belongs to Satan, leave it alone. Leave it alone. Because it won't do nothing but take you down the tubes. I'm telling you the truth. Scripture, just for a moment I want to use. I won't be but just a little bit. Because I get carried away sometimes and I don't know when to quit. Here in the 6th chapter of John, he says here in the 47th verse, it says, verily, verily, I say unto you. Now he was talking to those little disciples and the people back there of that day that was around him. But he put this Bible in our hands to read it, to believe what we, it's us he's talking to this morning.
That's right.
And biggest part of the time, well, I'm going to say biggest part of the time, I'll say all the time, that I get up to teach the gospel, to preach the gospel, I'm doing it for myself. I never find anything in the Word of God that don't talk to me.
That's right.
Speaks to my heart. Speaks to my heart. And you know, some of you probably know it, but I carry a doctor's degree on this. I've been through Bible college until I carry a doctor's degree. But you know that I can sit down and read this today, a verse of scripture that I have read over hundreds of times, and I will find something different that God's talking to me about.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't make any difference. It's just as real and new this morning as it was 30 years ago.
That's right.
I'm telling you the truth. God's speaking to your heart, your soul, and your mind right today, whatever we get into. But listen to that again. I like this. He says, verily, verily. In other words, he's saying, listen to me, guys. This is Jesus talking to him back. He says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he who believes on me has everlasting life. And I've had men and women to ask me that did not understand. It's a little hard for people that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ to know and understand when you tell them that they've got eternal life.
That's
They don't understand this eternal life. I have people that think, well, am I going to live forever? I said, no, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about a spiritual life. He's talking about a life with him. We will live forever. You die in this old body is going to give up one of these days. And when this body gives up, this soul and spirit of yours is going on to be with God.
That's right.
We're going to be walking through the portals of glory one of these days. And I'm telling you what, one of these days, and I don't believe it's going to be long. I keep looking and studying on the world today and the world we're living in today, and I keep thinking about it, and it's coming to an end fast.
Yes, it is.
You get into the book of Revelation and start studying on what he's talked about then, and now it is tying up right now.
That's right.
It's tying together.
Yes, it is.
Everything.
Yes, it is.
Is coming right down the line. It's really and truly happening. Our world is filling this Bible. Right now.
Yes, it is.
It's really and truly doing it.
Yes, it is.
You look at the world and what's going on in it. And I'm telling you, it's just sad when we see the things that's happening in the world today. But let's go on. It says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he who believes on me has everlasting life. And 48 says, I am the bread of life. I am the way. Now, can you imagine? Let's say, for instance, that a man would walk up to you, and I can just picture how Jesus was dressed in his white robe and that robe that he wore in those days. And I can see Jesus. I can really see Jesus with the beard hanging down to here and his hair hanging down to his shoulders or past. They show pictures of him sometimes, but I can picture him looking like this. But I can see a man and see a man walking up to you, and I just think about when he's talking to old Peter, the boys on the ship. And I can just hear him say, well, good morning, boys. Real neat, nice. Well, good morning, boys. You all doing all right this morning? And then he goes on to tell them, if you'll believe on me, you'll have everlasting life. He looked at those old fishermen. I listened to talking about it this morning, old Peter being that old hard fisherman. But when God really got a hold of him and really melted him down, after he went through the fire barrels and denied him the whole time, and God melted him down, and he made a man of God out of him. This big old fisherman. He didn't have no education, only know how to throw a fishing line. But he stepped out there, and he told everybody he came in contact with about this Jesus that he met and found.
Yes, he did.
On the road to Damascus. He found him. Whenever he walked out there, seen him on the river, and he said, boys, why don't you just get on? Come on, go with me. Now, can you see, in looking at a man standing there, and you've been on a job all of your life, you've done the same thing your entire life. And I don't know exactly, the Bible never tells us how old the disciples were, the apostles were, we don't know. But I can see Peter being a pretty man, pretty well up in age, and maybe 30, 40 years old, and fished all of his life. That's all he'd ever done, to make a living. And Jesus said, come on, follow me. In that calm voice of his. And I can see the boys, them fishermen, looking up at him and saying, you know, I don't quite understand this man, but I'm going with him. I'm going with this man. I'm going with this man. They just laid everything down, laid their fishing poles aside, something now they had did all their life, and they stepped up with him. Stepped off of that boat, and they followed him and stayed with him. And at one time through the ministry, old Peter denied him for a while. A little bit. But it wasn't but just a little while till Peter was back online where he belonged.
Yes.
And how many of us hasn't done that? I have failed myself and stumbled in life. But in a moment, I was right back online again. And it's easy to get back online. Jesus said, just call on me.
That's right.
Call on me. He told them boys, he said, just Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. Just follow me. And this was what was so important, what he told him to do. Let me read just a little more. And I know I'll try to wind this thing up here in just a little bit. But this, he went on to say, he said, not that any man has been the Father, save he which is of God. He has seen the Father. Verily I say unto you, he who believes on me. See there? He said it again. He didn't say anything else to believe on. People, I see this in the day we live, talking about this day coming to a head. I see the people of today that's worshiping everything you can imagine. When I was a missionary in the Philippines back years ago, I seen every kind of a god that you could imagine. They had every little thing as a god that they worshiped everything you could imagine. I'm telling you the truth. Until they really got a hold of the God that I'm preaching about and talking about. Until they got a hold of the Lord Jesus Christ. And again, we're talking about Jesus standing before men. I've stood before people that had never heard about Jesus. And they look at me like I was crazy. But I talk to them about the same thing. I'm like I'm talking to you all this morning about serving the Lord Jesus Christ. And how the Lord Jesus Christ would take them right on through. And they'd look at me, and yet when I gave an invitation, I've seen them come. I'd have in an auditorium over there, would be 1,000 people in. And I've seen them come by the hundreds up to the front. When I was back home, I was always used to praying with people, Brother Jimmy. I was always used to praying for people, laying my hands on people, praying for people. And I began to see these people coming to the front, and I began to think, well, how in the world am I going to pray for all of them? And they all came to the front, and I was talking through an interpreter, Brother Beswalen. And I told him, I said, Brother Beswalen, you tell those people here in the front to get a hold of hands, every one of them. And every one of them, they lashed hands in that cold congregation. They lashed hands. And I began to pray for them people.
Yes.
And I know that God took it down that chain.
Yes. Yes.
And touched everybody in that line. I watched them. I watched them come to know the Lord that morning by the hundreds.
Yes.
They come to know this Jesus that I know. And it made a difference like you've never seen before in your life. And those people right today are carrying the gospel in the Philippines like you wouldn't believe. So God knows what he's doing. He may do it in some funny ways sometimes. You know, it may seem funny to us, but God will move you around in different ways. He'll move you around. Let me tell you one other thing. There's some other scripture I wanted to get into, but I may not have time. But when I was in the Philippine Islands, being this little pastor, Brother Beswalen, had went up to Baguio City because I was setting churches in order and nurseries and missions and everything else over there. Anyway, we went up there and we was coming back and it was just getting dark and just starting to get dark. We was on this old rickety bus coming down the ain't highway like we got, coming down this old highway. Anyway, we come down there and it was just starting this rain. All of a sudden the bus stopped and we all got off, started getting off. And I said, well, Brother Beswalen, what's going on? And he said, brother, call me Brother Don. He said, Brother Don, he said, the bridge is out. The bridge. He said, the bridge. And the bridge across the river in front of us was washed out. And I said, well, Brother Beswalen, what are we going to do? And he said, Brother Don, I don't know. And I want to tell y'all something. I was standing there with tears running down my face. And I was saying, Lord, what in the world am I doing out here? And all of a sudden, Brother Beswalian, he said, Brother Don, I used to know a family right up on the side of this mountain. Let's go see if they're home. I said, okay. We walked up on the side of this mountain, and this went to the door, and this little lady come to the door, and it just thrilled her because she knew Brother Beswalian. And she took us right on in and got us some supper. What supper was, rice and something green. I don't know what it was. But anyway, I was glad to get it because I was hungry. And we began to eat. And him and Brother Beswalian and this lady were sitting there talking. You know, I mean, which I couldn't understand what he was talking about, but they were just talking of a storm. I found out that her husband, just a couple of months before that, had lost his head to the headhunters there in the mountain province. And laying all jokes aside, they still had headhunters. But anyway, sitting there talking about that time, a little teenage girl come at the door. Now, there was no knock, no nothing. She right come right on in there. And boy, she went to jabbering, and Brother Beswalian was listening to her. And Brother Beswalian looked over at me and he said, Brother Don, he said, or Brother Don, can you preach a funeral? And I said, well, sure, I can preach a funeral. You know, I thought maybe it might have been the next morning. And he said, Brother Don, he said, her mother's died. And said, she's been needing somebody for 3 days to preach her mother's funeral. So I said, okay. I stepped out. And we was walking in mud, guys. We was walking in mud. I had an old army flashlight that I took with me. I depended on that old army flashlight. And I was watching and went up this hut upon the top of the stakes, climbed up a ladder and climbed into a room. It was about, I'd say it was about a 12 by 12 room. I don't know what it was made out of, but the floor gave as I was walking on it. But anyway, that room was full of these small people. These people over there, I don't know if we've ever been around them or not, but they're just dark-complected, smaller people. They was all hunkered down. They didn't have no chairs. This little casket laying in the middle of the floor, and this little lady was laying in that. And they don't embalm over there, nothing. They didn't. And she was already starting to turn dark. But anyway, I looked at her, and this little lady, this little girl, had been in there with us down at the house. She was standing there crying. And I put my arm around her shoulder, and through Brother Beswalian, I talked to her. And I always carried that old Bible with me. And that old Bible, I opened it up. And I went to preaching the gospel to that room full of people. And I never preached a funeral in my life that I didn't give an invitation. And I gave an invitation that night when I got through preaching the gospel. And I want you to know, I don't know how many of them people. I asked them, I said, if you want to know Jesus as your Savior, raise your hand. And about half of them people raised their hand right there that night. And I said, Lord, I know why that bus broke down. I know why I was here right now. So we wonder sometimes about the things that God's doing. And we look at ourselves and we say, well, why are we here like I was? Well, why am I here? What am I doing here? Over here in the middle of a rainstorm. But I want you to know that God used me that night.
Amen.
And I was slopping back down through this mud. I said, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for using me. I thank you for using this guy on this hillside. Just continue to use me. And I went on and God used me in that place. I ministered to more people in the Philippines in that little over a year I was there. But I'm telling you, it was just something to see the people get saved in that place. Just one more scripture I've got here. I've rattled a little bit too much this morning. But in Romans 6:16, I want you to list this verse. He says, you are servants. You are servants of who you serve. And this is what's important, is who you serve. And that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I've had people, in fact, I even had it right here on the edge of St. Louis one time. I had a Jew that came into the church, and I could prove this by a minister who's still right there in St. Louis today. And that Jew listened to the message that morning. And I didn't know he was a Jew until it was all over. And he came up talking to me. And I told him, I said, I don't care what nationality you are, what color you are, red, yellow, black, or white. Jesus died on Calvary for all mankind. It don't make no difference who you are, what church you go to, nowhere. Jesus died for everybody in this building. Do you know him? Do you know him this morning? Brother Jim, let her go.
Father God, we come to you in the glorious name of Jesus, and we give you thanks, for indeed we have heard your truth. God, I believe that you have spoken to hearts this morning. Father, I know and believe in my heart that someone here today has a decision that is weighing heavy on their hearts. There is someone here who does not truly know the forgiveness of sin. There is someone here who is facing a difficulty. There is someone here who is seemingly up against the wall. They may seem like the odds are against them. They may even feel as if their situation is hopeless. But God, as your messenger has said this morning through the word that he has preached, and we have seen that there is hope in every situation. And God, that wherever we are, in whatever situation we are in, you can not only help us, but through us, help those around us. And so I pray that during this time of invitation, there would just be honesty in this house, that there would be obedience, and that God, folks would allow you to do what they cannot do. Yes. In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.